First time kaya itang nabinig si Brother Ray.
So, man.
Marami po kukuha nito. Sumisag ka.
Nag-uubo.
Yan din po. Nangarap ako sana walang ibang lahi para makasalita ng Diyos. Well, good evening, everyone. Such a privilege to be able to minister again the Word of God to you, brethren. Before we start, I'd like to remind everybody that we are in the series of studies about the book of Philippians. This is already the third lesson. And Brother Mike was very effective in sharing the first lesson. And he taught us about how the Philippian church was established. Do you still remember the lesson?
Damsels.
What happened is that supposedly Paul is going to Bithynia, but he was prevented by the Holy Spirit and directed him to go to Macedonia. And first he went to Philippi and established a church. And one of the first converts there was Lydia, a lady called, named Lydia. And because of that, because he ministered to the people in Philippi, he was persecuted, right? And what happened after that? Because of the sharing of the word of God in Philippi, he was persecuted, and then he was in prison. And because of that imprisonment, what happened? The jailer got saved. And not only him, but also his family. So that lesson would teach us that because of the preaching of the Word of God, because of the persecution, and because of the profession made by the jailer, the church in Philippi was established. And then last week, Brother Sam taught us about, can you remember? Called to be saints. The three type of people, you know, mentioned in the first verse of Philippians chapter 1, verse 1. First is saints, and then, servants, and then saints, and then the structure, deacons, and missions. So today, we'll study lesson number 3. I'd like to request everybody to please stand up. Let us open our Bible in Philippians chapter 1, verse 2 up to 5. That is verses 2 up to 5. We will read all together the verses. We'll start in verse 2. Are you there?
Amen.
Let's start with verse 2. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ.
I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in my prayer of mind for you all, making request with joy.
For your fellowship in the gospel from the third is now.
Let us pray. The Father in heaven, O Lord, we thank you for this time that you have given us to study your word, O Lord. We thank you for bringing all the brethren here, eager to study, O Lord, your word. Our prayer, Lord, is that you will give us wisdom, you give us understanding, so that we'll be able to understand your word and also apply it in our lives. Glorify your name. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good evening once again. If you study the book of Philippians, there are several lessons that we can learn from the book. We've learned last 2 weeks ago, we learned that the first church in Europe was planted the first church planted in Europe is the church in Philippi. So this is the very first church that was planted in Europe. God providentially and more directly guided Paul and those with him to Macedonia, and specifically Philippi, so that the first church will be established. A number were brought to faith by preaching of the gospel. We've mentioned about Lydia, her household, and then the jailer and his household. Hence, the first church in Europe was planted. Second, the Philippian church was used by Paul as an example of generosity. Probably you remember if you have attended missions conference, most often the book of Philippi is always mentioned because it is an example of generosity. So as to stipulate the Corinthians to follow through with their commitment to give to the needy saints in Judea. Actually, Apostle Paul used the church in Philippi to encourage the Corinthian believers to give what they have committed to missions. And then third, Philippians is an example of an epistle that gives us an entirely different standard for giving. Kakaiba kasi yung standard na binigay ni Apostle Paul at ng Panginoon dito sa Book of Philippi. Bakit kamo? Dahil yung Church of Philippi is poor. They don't have the resources to give. And yet they are able to give. Not only once, but several times. Makikita natin na hindi dahilan yung kawalan para makapagbigay. Kaya ibang standard ang naset ng Panginoon dito kung pag-aaralan natin yung Book of Philippi. This is the third. And the fourth, the Book of Philippians help us to define biblical fellowship. Repeat natin yung biblical fellowship. All too often, kasi yung akala ng iba, yung fellowship is synonymous to friendship. Or sa ibang terms, fellowship, kainan. Yun ang pagkakaintindi ng iba. For established friendships, and because of this friendship, maraming lalabas sa labas para kumain, and then the fellowship. However, this is not Apostle Paul is teaching or the Lord is teaching through the book of Philippians. We will learn this later on during the lesson. And then fifth, Philippians is a book that helped us to get a proper perspective on unjust suffering, persecution, and even death. Kasi yung pag-establish ng church ng Panginoon ay hindi nagdepende sa good times. It was not dependent on good times. Na-establish ang church ng Panginoon because of what? Sufferings, trials, persecution, and even death. So makikita natin yan sa Book of Philippians. Pero for today, ang ating lesson is all about fellowship. Fellowship in the Gospel. That's the title of the lesson for tonight. Our fellowship in the Gospel. It says in verse 2, "Grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making request with joy, for your fellowship in the Gospel from the first day until now." In the passage that we read, we see some basic elements of church life, particularly fellowship. I've mentioned this earlier. Or fellowshipping. Privilege of fellowshipping for the sake of the Gospel within the local church body. So, point number one, we can see here the spirit of Christianity. We can see that the greeting of Paul started with what? Grace. Started with grace. It says, "Grace be unto you and peace from our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." The apostle's greeting is an expression of his deep love for his fellow believers. Makikita natin na yung pagmamahal ni Apostle Paul sa mga kapwa niya mananampalataya ay nandoon. Makikita natin kasi ang unang bugad pa lang niya is grace and peace be with you. Ibig sabihin talagang concern siya sa mga believers and the love for the believers is there. Okay? Makikita natin dito yung expression. A is expression. Expression. As I mentioned, Paul greets with grace. That is the first word that was mentioned in verse number 2. What is the meaning of grace?
Unmerited favor.
It is, that means, grace is unmerited favor of God toward man. Okay, in Luke chapter 1 verse 30 it says, "And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God." Makikita natin na yung grace ay binibigyan ng Panginoon without conditions. without exemption. Unmerited nga eh, di ba? We don't deserve it, and yet God is giving it. In our lesson, it says we need God's grace throughout our Christian life. Unang-una, we need grace for our salvation. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Let us read that. If somebody can read it. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Yeah, verses 8 and
9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast.
We should always remember that we are saved not because of our works. It is because, only because of the grace of God. So we cannot be saved without the grace of God. And then, not only that, we need grace also, not only in our salvation, but also in stewardship. Stewardship. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Let's read that. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7.
2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Therefore, as ye abound in every good thing, in faith, in utterance, and knowledge, and in all diligence, and in your love to us, see that ye abound in this grace force.
See that ye abound in this grace force. It's not all about faith, knowledge, but also grace in stewardship. It's against the grain of humanity to give. Diba? Laging inisip natin ano yung what we can get. Ganun yung grain of humanity. Inisip natin, ako lagi ang dapat muuna. Ang blessing dapat ako ang una sa blessing, ako ang una dapat kumain, ako ang lahat. Ganun ang human nature. And yet, because of the grace of God, we are able to overturn that. Nabaliktad, di ba? Because of the grace of God, we are being taught to give. You know, the grace of God is urging us to give. Kasi kung wala yung grace of God, we will not be able to give. Kasi pag kami dumating sa impera, isipin mo muna, ah, kailangan ko to, kailangan ng pamilya. Kailangan ko to upang isustain yung pangangailangan ko at pangangailangan ng pamilya. But then, God is teaching us to be good stewards. And one of the traits of being a good steward is being able to share what you have received and give what is the portion of the Lord. Amen? This is good stewardship. Because we are only stewards of all these blessings. We are not the owners of it. We are just managers. And being managers, you are abided by the rules. Amen?
Amen.
And one of the rules of God is for you to give 10% of what you earn.
Right.
Amen? And because you are a manager only, you are to
give.
Abide by the rule. Amen? And then, not only about stewardship, but also thanksgiving. So we need God's grace throughout our Christian life, in our salvation, in stewardship, and also in thanksgiving. Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 30. 1 Corinthians 10, 30.
13, for if I by grace be a partaker, why am I even spoken of for that for which I give thanks?
Diba kung tayo ay niligtas ng Panginoon, dapat natural na ang pagiging grateful and thankful. It should be part of our lives to be grateful and thankful in everything and in anything. Sometimes we are thankful if we are blessed. But if we are already having problems, we tend to forget to be thankful and grateful. Ang tinuturo sa atin ng Panginoon, even if you have nothing, you should be thankful.
Amen.
Dahil yung kaligtasan na pinagkaloob sa atin ng Panginoon ay enough na para maging grateful forever.
Amen.
Our salvation is already enough for us to be grateful.
Amen.
Forever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Many Christians do not wish favor on their fellow believers. Unlike Paul, sa lahat ng mga epistles niya, laging ang salutation niya is grace and peace to the believers. Pero hindi na ito natural sa tao. it's not natural for you to hope good things for other people.
Right.
Kasi lagi niyang sarili lang ang iniisip natin, di ba? We do not wish favor on other believers sometimes. We too easily fall into sins of envy and jealous. Na minsan, pagka nakikita natin ibang tao na be-blessed, naiingit tayo. At gusto din natin kung ano nangyari sa iba, mangyari din sa atin. Tama ba yun? Hindi madali eh, kasi yun yung human nature. Kaya sinasabi dito na nakikita natin yung expression ni Paul na lagi niyang ginagamit grace and peace. Kasi nga mahal niya yung mga kapwa niya mananampalataya. Dahil sa pagmamahal niya sa kapwa mananampalataya, nag-wish siya na yung lahat ng mananampalataya ay lumago hindi lamang sa kanilang spiritual life, kundi sa kanilang mga buhay dito sa mundo. Nakikita natin yun eh, sa mga leso o sa mga epistles na sinulat ni Paul. It is his expression. Not only, I mentioned already peace earlier, yung first is grace and then the next is peace. However, we can only have peace if we have grace.
Right.
Or if we exercise grace.
Right.
Hindi natin ma-enjoy yung peace na pinagkakaloob ng Panginoon kung wala yung una. Amen ba?
Yeah.
Kailangan maligtas ka muna bago mo ma-enjoy yung grace. Yung peace. Kaya sa mundo, walang kapayapaan.
Right.
Hindi nila makakamtan yung kapayapaan. You may have all the riches in the world and yet you will not have peace.
Right.
Kasi yung mayayaman, ang dami na nilang pera and yet hindi pa rin sila satisfied, hindi pa rin sila makatulog, wala pa rin silang peace. Yung iba nga, dahil sa karamihan ng pera nila, hindi nila alam kung paano enjoy yung pera, natatakot sila kasi baka makidnap sila or baka kung ano mangyari sa kanila. So walang peace. Sinasabi dito na you can only have peace if you have grace. So makakamtan mo lang ang totoong kapayapaan if you have the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart because of the reasons. Amen po ba doon? Okay? Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. This is in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. And also in Colossians chapter 1, verse 20, it says, and having made peace through the blood of His cross. Makikita natin dito, we have peace because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of our salvation. We cannot enjoy peace if we are not saved. Napaka-imposible po yun. Imposible. Nakamtan ng kapayapaan kung wala ang Panginoong Jesucristo sa iyong buhay. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, very popular verse. Ano ba yung peace na sinasabi? Basahin nyo natin yun. Philippians chapter 4, verse 7.
And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Thank you, Brother Gary. It says, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding. Kaya nga napakahirap ipaliwanag. It's very difficult to explain what this peace is. Only believers can explain. Hindi yan maintindihan ng iba.
Right.
Hindi yan maintindihan ng iba. Makikita natin doon sa account ni Paul when he was in prison, makikita natin na kahit na si Peter na napag-aralan natin sa doctrine class the other week, na kahit na in prison na sila, ang ginagawa nila, they were singing and they are sharing the word of God kahit na nakakulong na sila. Maganda example sa lahat ito, di ba? Kasi minsan magkaroon pa lang ng sakit, nakalimutan mo na yung biyaya ng Panginoon. Na magkaroon ka ng problema, nawawala ka na sa church, nagtatampo ka na sa Panginoon. Diba? Yung iba nga hindi lang tampo, nagre-rebelde pa sa Panginoon. Yung iba nag-utter pa ng salita na ang unfair yata yung Panginoon. I've been faithful and yet I'm experiencing this. And yet, dun sa buhay ng mga apostles, makikita natin, even though the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, even they were in the middle of suffering, they are able to what? To have peace and praise God. And also not only praising God, but you know, even sharing the word of God. Kaya babalik tayo dun sa unang point. You can only have peace if you have grace of God. So you will only have peace during problems if you have
the grace
of God. Kaya nga sabi, hindi mo makukuha yung pangalawa kung wala ka nung una. Very important. Kaya lagi sa mga salutations ni Paul, sinasabi niya grace and peace. Laging nauuna yung grace. Hindi peace and grace be with you. Laging grace and peace be with you. Kasi nauuna yung grace. Without grace, you will not experience peace. Yun yung sinasabi ng lesson natin. That is the expression. And then the origin. Origin. Ano ba sa Pilipinas, sa Tagalog? Ang origin. Ang pinagmulan. Or ang nagkaloob. Paul greets with grace and peace, but it is not from him. Hindi ito nanggagaling sa kanya. Rather, it is from the Heavenly Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. God made it possible for us to receive grace and peace. Sinabi dito sa isang quotation, God cannot give us happiness and peace apart from Himself because it is not there. There is no such thing. Hindi mo makikita yung grasya ng Panginoon at yung kapayapaan sa mundo. It is impossible. You can only find peace and you can only find grace from God. In Jesus. And with God. Talaga yan. Sa mga magulo ang buhay before, bago nakilala ang Panginoon, mapapatunayan mo ito. Hindi mo kayang bilihin ang kapayapaan. Hindi mo kayang bilihin yan. Ang Panginoon lang ang kayang magbigay.
Amen.
Ibigay lang sa iyo yung peace na yan kung meron siyang grasya sa buhay.
Amen.
If you learn to exercise grace in your life. No peace without grace. Inward peace springs from a sense of divine favor. Ito yung sinasabi natin. Favor from God. Kaya nga, grace is unmerited favor. Kung wala yung favor ng Panginoon, wala yung kapayapaan. No grace and peace, but from God our Father, the fountain and origin of blessings, the Father of lights, from whom cometh down every good and perfect. I remember yung post ni Brother Ronald the other week, James 1.17. Ano ba yung James 1.17?
In every perfect gift and good gift is from God.
Good and perfect gift are from Allah. Galing lang sa Panginoon yung grace and peace. No grace and peace from God our Father, but in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ is our mediator and is the channel of conveyance of all spiritual blessings to the church and to its members. Di ba? Ang kaligtasan natin ay through what? Grace through faith. Faith in whom? The Lord Jesus Christ. Kung walang Panginoong Hesukristo, wala rin kapayapaan. Amen? Yung channel ng kapayapaan ay through the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the mediator. Okay. As in Philippians chapter 1 verse 2, we see the Father and the Son equally referred to as God throughout the epistles. It is also mentioned in Jude verse 1. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus and called. So makikita natin dito yung pagiging Diyos ng Panginoon sa Kristo. Dito sa mga verses. And even the epistles na sinulat ni Apostle Pablo. So yun yung una. Number one, ano ba yung una? The spirit of Christianity. And then the second one is the supplication of the apostle. Ano ba yung supplication? Ano ba yung pagkakaintindi natin sa supplication?
Request.
Request? What else? Ano ba yung intindi natin sa supplication? Brother Emil. Ano ba yung supplication? Ano ba yung pagkakaintindi natin sa supplication?
Request.
What you are praying for to God. Sinabi kanina, request. Actually, supplication is something that you beg for. You are asking humbly. Merong pagpapakumbaba. yung supplication, ipapukpak-pakumbaba. Makita natin in verse 3, sa text natin, verse 3 it says, I thank my God upon remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, for you all making request with joy. Makikita natin, sinabi niya with joy. Letter A, comprised of gratitude. Makikita natin, they were grateful for their salvation. Makikita natin na sinabi ni Apostle Paul dito na, I thank my God upon remembrance of you. Naaalala niya kung ano yung nangyari sa kanya nung nandun siya sa Pilipan. Diba? Dumating siya doon, sinear niya yung salita ng Panginoon, nasave yung mga tao doon, at naaalala niya lahat ng nangyari doon. Naaalala niya with gratefulness. Okay? With gratefulness. Gratefulness dahil sa kanilang kaligtasan. They were grateful for their salvation. Remember Lydia and her household, na pag-aralan natin 2 weeks ago, were the first Christian converts in Europe and became the nucleus. Ano yung nucleus? Sila yung center or yung core ng church, you know, the continent's first church. The generosity and hospitality they exhibited characterized the congregation for years to come. Kasi hanggang ngayon, example pa rin yung ginawa ni Lydia at saka ng household niya at saka ng Philippian church. Nakita natin yun. Dahil sa salvation na nakamtan nila by accepting the Lord Jesus Christ, by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, yung dahil naging grateful sila sa kanilang salvation, hanggang ngayon, example pa rin sila. Kaya naalala ko yung kanta, yung very first song na kinanta ng choir noon sa Missions Conference. May the Lord find us faithful. Ano susunod doon? Makikita doon na hindi sana makita ng Panginoon na tayo ay faithful. At hindi lang tayo faithful, pati yung mga may iiwan natin, makikita tayo na faithful. Diba? Ganito yung Philippian Church. Naging faithful sila sa Panginoon na hanggang ngayon, example pa rin sila ng faithfulness. Not only of faithfulness, but also of generosity. Dahil sa kanilang gratitude, sa kanilang salvation. Sinabi sa 1 Corinthians 1 verse 4, I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Christ Jesus. In 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 13, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. Makikita natin dito na yung mga churches na established, yung mga early churches in Thessalonica, in Corinthian, in Philippians, they were all grateful about their salvation. Makita mo? Na yun din yung tinuturo sa atin ng Apostle Paul dito, na kailangan maging grateful tayo sa salvation na binigay sa atin ng Panginoon, at maging grateful tayo at meron tayong church na inattend na para ma-appreciate natin ang biyaya ng Panginoon.
Man.
Sinabi ni Helen Keller, so much has been given me, I have no time to ponder over that which has been denied. Kumbaga, kung anong meron siya, grateful na siya doon. Hindi na niya maalala kung ano yung mga prayers niya na na-deny at hindi pinagkaloob ng Panginoon. Kasi kung ano man ang na-receive niya, already enough for her to be grateful. Yun yung sinasabi ni Helen Keller dito. Yun yung binanggit ko kanina, na kapag tayo ay namang problema o wala pera sa bulsa, o nawalan tayo ng trabaho, isipin lang natin yung day na niligtas tayo ng Panginoon.
Amen.
That's already enough to uplift our spirit and be grateful. Amen? They were also grateful for their stewardship. Sinabi sa isang quote, it is impossible to become a fully developed follower of Jesus without also becoming a fully developed steward of your resources. Kaya man dalito. Napakahirap na sabihin na ikaw ay isang mature na Kristiyano kung hindi ka marunong magbigay sa gawa ng Panginoon. Kasi indication ng maturity ay yung level of giving. Barometer ng Christian maturity yung level of giving. Amen ba doon? Kaya the more you mature in Christ, the more you give. Pero kung 10 taon pa ng Kristiyano, yung level of giving mo ay nandun pa rin sa level 1, ibig sabihin, hindi ka nagmamature sa pananampalataya. Diba? Sinabi dito, it is impossible to become a fully developed follower of Christ without also becoming a fully developed steward of your resources. Giving was an evidence of their faith. Diba? Mahirap sila. Hindi nga sila able to give, and yet they gave. Bakit? Dahil iyon ay ebidensya ng kanilang pananampalataya. Ebidensya na sila ay nagtitiwala sa Panginoon na kung sila ay magbibigay, pagpapalain sila ng Panginoon. Iyon yung lesson na makikita natin sa Book of Philippians. Now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. For even in Thessalonica, ye sent once and again unto my necessity. We can compare this with the church in Corinthians. The members in the Corinthian church were rich. Amen? Pero makikita natin, basahin natin yung Corinthians, yung first book and second book, makikita natin, yung mga Christians doon ay carnal. Dahil sa kanilang carnality, yung kanilang giving hindi nag-grow. Nakita natin yun? Nakita natin yung difference? Kaya sinasabi dito, yung level of maturity ng isang Kristiyano ay masusukat sa kanyang pagbibigay. Yun yung barometer. The more passionate our faith is, the more consistent our giving will be. Amen ba doon? The more passionate our faith is the more consistent our giving will be. Letter B, continuous in joy. Continuous in joy. The word making is from Greek word poio, which means to make, with the names of things made, to produce, construct, form, fashion, etc. This word implies naming things that are being made. Kasi sinabi niya dito, sa verse 4, always in every prayer of mine, for you all making requests with joy. Making requests. So making is to produce, construct, form, fashion. And then request comes from the Greek word desis. D-E-E-S-I-S. Or desis. Which means a need, asking, entreating to God or to man. The same word that is translated here as request is the Greek word that is also translated supplication. Okay? Paul makes his requests with joy. Remember, ano yung sitwasyon ni Paul when he wrote to the church in Philippi? Nasaan ba siya?
Crazy.
You remember? Nasaan siya? Nasaan siya? Nasa Rome. Nakakulong siya sa Rome. Okay? Paul's circumstances at the time he wrote this letter were dire. He was imprisoned in Rome, possibly facing execution. He was under house arrest, chained to a Roman soldier. As it turned out, he was released from this imprisonment, but he was not certain that would be the case when he wrote to the Philippians. Makikita natin yung sitwasyon ni Paul. He was in prison. Hindi niya alam ang certainty ng mangyayari. And yet, yung kanyang greeting, what? Grace and peace. Tapos hindi lang yun, ang kanyang prayer is with joy. Madali bang manalangin para sa iba kung namumroblema ka? Madali ba yun? Mahirap, di ba? Kasi minsan nga, manalangin para sa iyo, mahirap na eh, magmanalangin ka pa para sa iba. Hindi lang manalangin para sa iba, may joy pa sa puso mo. Di ba? Nakuha niyo yun, ikaw niyo. Pero sa sitwasyon ni Paul, despite of his circumstances, he is praying for others with joy. Praying for others with joy. Because joy only comes from the Holy Ghost. Ang Holy Spirit lang ang makakapagbigay sa atin Kasi kahit marami kang pera, maganda trabaho mo, ganda ng kotse mo, makukuha mo ba yung joy? Probably happiness for a time, pero yung joy wala. Dahil ang joy ay nanggagaling lang sa banal na spirito. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Sa Panginoon lang nanggagaling mo. Kaya kaya mo lang magdasal para sa ibang tao nang may kasiyahan sa puso mo kung ibinibigay sa iyo ng banal na spirito. Hindi mo kaya magdasal para sa iba kung ikaw mismo na may problema. Kung wala kang una, yung grasya ng Panginoon, pangalawa, yung peace, yung pangatlo, yung joy. Amen ba doon? Sunod-sunod din, no? Grace, peace, joy. Joy comes from serving others. Yung mga nagsaserve dito, di ba? Kahit napupuyat, kahit puyat na, kailangan magsilbi, nagsisilbi pa rin. Tapos after that, may joy sa puso mo, di ba? Because joy comes from serving others. Even as Paul was in prison, he was serving the church at Philippi through his prayers and by sending his epistle. Nakikita natin na nag-i-help na siya, pero ang isip niya nasa pagsisilbi pa rin sa iba. Joy also comes from new Christians. Do you agree? Right. Di ba pagka bagong ligtas, yung eagerness to serve nandun, laging masaya. Kumbaga, laging on the go. No? Laging on the go. Paul was pouring his life into discipling those who were babes in Christ. Laging sinasabi niya to, di ba? Sa Corinthians, di ba? Kahit kay Timothy, nung bagong ligtas pa lang siya, talagang inalagaan niya para lumago. A newborn gives joy to the whole family. Sino naman baby? Hindi ko pa na-experience. In much the same way, a newborn Christian gives joy to the church family as well as our heavenly family. Sinasabi sa Luke chapter 15 verse 7, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over the sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Isang soul lang, di ba? Meron daw joy sa heaven.
Amen.
So newborn babes o newborn Christians, nagbibigay daw ito ng joy. Ano ba yung joy sa pagkakas? Kagalakan. Hindi lang kasiyahan kung hindi kagalakan. So yun ang number two. Yun yung supplication ni Paul. Yun yung prayer niya. Ang prayer niya ay ano? With joy. Okay? And number three, the service of ministry. 5 minutes na lang. 5 minutes. The service of ministry. In verse 5 it says, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. Makikita natin na yung mananampalataya doon sa Philippi ay nagfe-fellowship mula nung sila ay maligtas until such time na sinusulat ni Paul yung kanyang sulat. Years na to, ha? Hindi lang ito 1 week or 1 month. Makikita natin ang united in fellowship or united fellowship. 5a. Sinabi dito, from the first day until now. Ano ba yung meaning ng fellowship? Nabanggit natin ito kanina. The Greek word for fellowship is koinonia. Koinonia. Ang hirap pa in Greek. Which means fellowship, association, community, communion, joint participation. The share which one has in anything, or participation, or intercourse, fellowship, intimacy. This word implies fellowship by association of a common bond in our fellowship. Meron daw common bond. Kung ikaw ay nakikipag-fellowship sa inuman, anong common bond nyo?
Yung alak.
Kung ikaw ay nakikipag-fellowship sa sugalan, anong common bond nyo?
Pera.
Pera.
Ang Christian fellowship, ano ang common bond na?
Pagkain.
Baptist yun, hindi
pagkain spiritual.
Yes, diba? Gospel. Ang Baptist, ang fellowship pagkain. Yung Kristiyano, anong fellowship natin?
Gospel.
Or gospel. Yung gospel. Yun ang fellowship natin. Brother Bong, mamaya, nandito tayo because of the Word of God, because of the gospel. Yun yung common bond natin. Sinabi sa Philemon, "If thou found me therefore a barter, receive him as myself." Sinabi ni Apostle Paul kay Philemon. Thank God we can partner with others in the ministry. The fellowship of the local church is far bigger than ethnicity or race. Diba? Mapapatunayan natin yan. Brother Samuel is here. It's not all about ethnicity or race.
Right.
Or place. Or background. Or culture. Diba? Hindi yun yung bond. Ano yung bond natin?
The gospel.
Gospel. Regardless of ethnicity, regardless of race, regardless of color, regardless of background, regardless of culture, and regardless of the place. Amen? Satan always hates Christian fellowship. It is his policy to keep Christians apart. Okay? Anything which can divide saints from one another, he delights in. He attaches far more importance to godly intercourse than we do. Since union is strength, he does his best to promote separation. Ito ay according kay Charles Spurgeon. Si Charles Spurgeon ang nagsabi nito na ang pinopromote ni Satan is separation. Kaya gustong-gusto niya kapag ka sa church merong chismis, yung isa kampi doon, yung iba kampi doon. Gustong-gusto ni Satan yun. Kaya gustong-gusto ni Satan yung nagchichismisan yung mga church members. Kaya pag kayo nagchichismis, gustong-gusto ni Satan yung kakampi na kayo. So yun. Okay?
Right.
But how do we achieve right. United in fellowship? Paano man na-achieve yun? Hindi lang naman sa salita, di ba? Okay. We can achieve fellowship through giving. It says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 15 to 16, "Now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. For even in Thessalonica, ye sent once and again unto my necessity." Nagbond yung Philippian church dahil may need. Diba? Dahil may need, nagbond sila. Dahil sa kanilang bonding, nagkaroon sila ng fellowship. Ang fellowship nila ay dahil sa
need.
Dahil sa kanilang pananampalataya sa Panginoon. Diba? Kung wala pananampalataya sa Panginoon, walang bond, walang fellowship, hindi nila ma-feel yung need, hindi nila ma-feel ang tumulong. Amen? So dahil doon sa kanilang pagtulong, nagkaroon ng unity sa church. There was unity in church because of their giving. Amen?
Amen.
And then, through preaching the gospel. Sinabi sa 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, "God is faithful, by whom ye called unto fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord." Nagkakaroon ng unity ang church, unity in fellowship ang church, if the church is united in proclaiming the Word of God, in proclaiming the Gospel, in sharing the Gospel. Makikita natin ito, pagka ang church ay mission-minded, laging dumadami, may mawawala, may papalit. Dumadami yung numbers. Pero makikita mo yung church na hindi lumalago, hindi sila involved sa sharing the Word of God. Dead church. Bakit dead na yung church sa Europe ngayon? Yung mga first churches. Siguro ganun. Kasi hindi na sila naging united. Kasi ano ba yung common bond ng church?
The gospel.
The gospel. Diba? Kung hindi yun ang priority ng church, mawawala yung grasya ng Panginoon, yung magiging ikabod tayo, yung binanggit sa Bible na ikabod. Mawawala yung grace ng Panginoon. Nagkakaroon ng unity, yung ating fellowship, dahil sa salita ng Panginoon, dahil sa gospel. Because of the preaching of the gospel. Yung una, through giving, at saka pangalawa, yung preaching ng gospel. And number three, through separation. Separation from what? And from whom? Yun ang tanong.
From the world.
From?
The world.
Separation from the world. James chapter 1, 27, it says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Okay, pasa naman. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2.
Romans 12, verse 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Makikita natin, if we are separated, we are united. Diba? Makikita natin dito. Kapag ka pumasok na ang chismis sa church, are we still... Anong point dito? Are we undefiled if we allow Satan to come in? Nagiging undefiled, diba? And because of that, nagkakaroon ng separation ng church. Amen? But if we are near the heart of God, anong magiging doon? Magiging separated pa tayo from the world. Malayo tayo sa kasalanan. Malayo tayo sa separation. Nakita natin yung point doon. Magkakaroon tayo ng unity sa church or united fellowship kung nagbibigay tayo. Number two, kung pinipreach natin yung gospel. At number three, kung separated tayo from the world. Marami ng churches ang naghiwalay, namatay, dahil bakit? Dahil sa number three, hindi sila separated from the world. Hindi sila rooted sa salita ng Panginoon. Yun yung danger. Kaya dapat nating laging isipin na for the church to have unity, tatlo yung bagay. Kailangan tayo magbigay sa gawain ng Panginoon. Kailangan nating i-preach ang gospel. At kailangan tayo maging separated from the world. Yun yung key, yun yung ingredient ng isang united fellowship. Kasi kung wala yung isa dito sa tatlong ito, hindi tayo magiging unit. Simple lang yan eh, di ba? Kahit isang bagay na binrot up sa congregation, hindi magkasundo-sundo yung members. Bakit ka mo? Kasi, di ba? Hindi na naayon sa pangatlo eh. Diba? If you are separated from the world, ang dali ka mo na mag-agree. Diba? Tama ba yun? Ang dali. Pero pagka hindi ka separated sa world, naku, maniwala ka isang bagay lang, hindi magkakasunduan ng marami. United in fellowship. Ito yung makikita natin sa book, sa Philippian Church. They were united. Diba? They were united. At magandang example hanggang ngayon, ilang years na, 2,000 years na ang lumipas. And yet, they are still a good example to us. Amen. Because they were united. They were united as a church. And not only united, they have unbroken fellowship. Unbroken fellowship. From the first day, the Christians within the church at Philippi had been faithful. Lydia, the jailer, and the other new Christians from Acts chapter 16 were faithful until now. Makita natin, hindi lang sa simula hanggang sa dulo. Kaya nga yung kanta, may the Lord find us faithful until He comes. Until He comes. In conclusion, one day we will see the Lord Jesus Christ face to face, and like the song title says, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Our fellowship in the gospel, our spirit of grace, our supplication of joy, our service together will be worth every effort when we see our Savior and continue our fellowship together with Him. I hope you learned something. Can we pray? Your Father in heaven, O Lord, we thank you for the lesson tonight, O Lord. Thank you for the reminder that we should be united in our fellowship, O Lord, through our giving, through preaching the Word of God, O Lord, and through being separated from the world, O Lord. Thank you for this reminder, O Lord. May this be in our hearts forever until you come, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.